It's finally here. Welcome to the top 10 best movies list of 2015. Now, these are all my personal opinions. These are movies that I particularly thought were the best of 2015, okay? We had a good year this year, so this was kind of hard to pick this time around. This wasn't slim pickings like 2014 was, okay? So this one, you know, forgive me if your movie doesn't appear on this list. That doesn't mean that it's not good. It just means that I either didn't see it or my personal opinion, it just wasn't as good to make the list. So we could make the honorable mentions list as well, which I'm going to go over in a second. If you want to skip to certain parts, links will be in the description for each one of those, both for the honorable mentions, the top 10 movies on the best list individually, as well as the special announcement I'm going to have towards the end of the video. So without further ado, let's get into it. Here we're going to go with the honorable mentions list first. We're going to switch it up from last year where I said my top 10 and then I did the honorable mentions. I'm not going to make this video as long as last year, okay? So when I go through the honorable mentions list, I'm just going to read off the movies and just give my opinion on one to two sentences on why the movies did not make the top 10 best list. But basically put, they didn't make the top 10 not because they were bad. All right, if they appear on the honorable mentions list, that means that they're still good enough to see. It's just that there was better movies that came out. Okay, so don't hate me for this. All right, so there might be a few surprises here. So all right, so we're gonna start off with the honorable mentions list. I have it right here and I'm just gonna read it off to you. Okay, number one, Ant-Man. This movie I actually just seen earlier this year. It's really good. Possibly one of the weakest of the Marvel movies, but with that being said, it's still on a scale of 1 to 10, or out of 4 stars, it's still a 3 star, okay? So a scale of 1 to 10, possibly a 7.5, all right? You know, it's still a good movie, still worth seeing, especially if you're a Marvel fan or not. Marvel's on a roll, and I hope they continue to be so. Avengers Age of Ultron. Okay, the reason why this one didn't make the list, it was a little bit too much like the first one, and it was trying to make a statement that has already been made in other movies, better movies actually. That doesn't mean that this is a bad film. You should definitely go see it if you haven't already. It's the Avengers, how can you not love it? Black Mass, this was featuring Johnny Depp. This was the one I thought that was going to get him an Oscar. I remember saying this in the review, how I thought this was possibly one of his best performances in years since almost 10 years ago. Was it 2016 we're in? Sweeney Todd was like really like the last breakout performance for him, and that one he should have got an Oscar in, and this one he does really good in this, but sadly it was overshadowed by better movies this year. Cinderella 2015, this was the live-action version of Disney. I had no expectations for this movie. Turned out to be much better than what I thought. I really enjoyed it. Everest, this was the movie about these explorers who lost their lives on Mount Everest, and so they made a movie about it. It's Jake Gyllenhaal, Jason Clarke, Josh Brolin, a number of actors are in this, and it turned out to be really good. But you know, if you're not into that sort of movie where, you know, this is based on a true story and these people actually died and stuff like that, or this thing actually happened, then you're not gonna like this. Frozen Fever. This was a short for Frozen. It was actually kind of enjoyable. It was cutesy. I don't know whether it's going to win any awards at the animated shorts. I don't know if it even is going to the Oscars, but this will be interesting for Disney in case they do get a mention at least for it. Goosebumps. I love Goosebumps as a kid. I love the television show. I love the books. Never really found Goosebumps scary. And it seems like this movie is sort of, it knows that. It's self-aware. To the point where it actually can make fun of some of these tropes of R.L. Stein's work and still happen to be somewhat intimidating at times, okay? Jack Black is really kind of awkward in this film, but somewhat enjoyable. I don't know why. Every time he was on screen, it was great. And the other actors did fine, too. I thought the kids was actually pretty good. Hotel Transylvania 2. Most pretty much like the first one, not big of a difference here. I would say that the first one was a stronger film, but I never got a chance to mention it. I never got a chance to review any of these films. But I love the characters, and this was definitely one of the better Adam Sandler movies to come out this year. And I think it got bashed a little bit too much, mostly because Adam Sandler was just a part of it. And it's a shame because it actually is good. Jurassic World. You should already know why this is not going to make my best list. I looked forward to this. There were some things that let me down, some things that I did kind of enjoyed about it. But overall, it sort of can be said that it's sort of a meh film. What kept this from being meh, not being mentioned on any of these lists, has to be the definitely the last part of the movie, Chris Pratt himself, and of course the Raptors. I just like the Raptors. I made a review about this, so you know you can go check out that review if you like. McFarland U.S.A. This was the movie that featured Kevin Costner. This was also a Disney film. It's really good. It's a story about these young Hispanic men who grew up in not such a good neighborhood, but became something of themselves. Run All Night is the next one. This is with Liam Neeson and Ed Harris. They go head to head in this sort of like a mafia versus hitman thing. It's just awesome. It's a Liam Neeson movie that isn't Taken 3, thank God. And it was good. It was a lot of fun. Kind of remind me of Nonstop a little bit. I think Nonstop was possibly better. It was more of a mystery there. But this one was pretty good. I hope Liam Neeson continue to make some more movies like these. The SpongeBob SquarePants movie, was it Sponge Out of Water or something like that? I didn't write the whole name down. Whatever, it'll be up on the screen. It's a SpongeBob movie. It's SpongeBob. It was a lot of fun to watch. Antonio Banderas as the pirate was pretty cool. Of course, you know, you got Tom Kenny and the rest of them doing the voices of the respectable characters. And it's SpongeBob. You can't really go wrong with that. You know, SpongeBob movie has actually surprised me more than once. Quentin Tarantino's The Hateful Eight. I actually just seen this the other night, and it's a pretty good film. It has a lot of the Tarantino tropes in it. And there's nothing that really stood out to me, though. I wanted to put this on the list, but there were just better movies. I'm not going to go into too much detail about it, because if I do, it might be giving away the ending for people who haven't seen it yet. But it's a good film if you're used to those Tarantino tropes and you like them. And, you know, there was in the other movies such as Kill Bill and Django Unchained. You're going to like it here. Django Unchained is a much better film, in my opinion, and much more enjoyable than this. I kind of figured out where this was kind of going. And I don't think Tarantino is losing his edge. This was just sort of, we're just kind of used to this now. This is his eighth film in his franchise, so. In the Tarantino franchise, so there you go. And lastly, the Peanuts movie. I made a late critique on this. I really enjoy the Peanuts movie. If you enjoy the comic strip or the TV show or the specials, you're going to love this. Blue Sky Studio did a fantastic job on it. If you want to know more of my opinion, go check out that review. Okay, so that's it for the honorable mentions, and let's get right into it. So these are the top 10 best movies of 2015. Number 10, Kurt Cobain, Montage of Heck. Now, I don't think I put any type of documentary on my top 10 best list of 2014. So this is actually the first time I put a documentary on any of my top best lists. This one was really good. It talks about the late singer Kurt Cobain, who I think committed suicide in the 90s. And basically his life story and how he came to be who he was and how he most likely ended up going through depression and ultimately taking his own life at the age, I think, 28 years old. Really fascinating story. Really dives into the depth of this person and how he really felt. I enjoyed this a lot more than what I thought. It was actually my mother who seen this, and she was like, He's like, oh, you have to see this. So I was like, okay, you know, sometimes, you know, you can definitely get some good movies out there. So I was like, okay, so what is this about? She's like, oh, it's about Kurt Cobain. I'm like, okay, so who's Kurt Cobain? She's like, the musician? I'm like, okay. I didn't know anything about Kurt Cobain. I'm sorry. When he died, I was a kid. I'm pretty sure. So I didn't know a lot about him. I was into Disney stuff at that time. Forgive me, you know, Lion King shit. Nothing I can do. Beauty and the Beast, nothing I can do. So she told me to sit down and watch it. So I gave it a chance to sit down and watch it. And this was a really well-done documentary. There were a couple more documentaries that also came out last year. I think there was one about Amy Winehouse, and then there was one about Daft Punk. And these seem to be sort of like the best documentaries when they're talking about musicians. And it's sad to say, I'm laughing here, but it's definitely a tearjerker, and it gets you right here, man. And you feel for this guy, and it's just like you wanna help him, but just knowing that it's too late just can really get you. If you have a chance, check it out. It's a really good documentary, man. It beat out all the rest of these movies, which are made from like studios like Marvel and Disney and things like that. And it's just really good. That's pretty much all I can say. It's a very well done documentary, and I hope the people who made this continue to make more. So that's it. Moving on. Number 9, Furious 7. Okay, so believe it or not, I stopped watching the Fast and Furious movies. I knew exactly where this was going to go. I stopped watching the films once the second one became a thing. I didn't really like the second one, okay? By the time the third one rolled around with Tokyo Drift, and that was kind of a disappointment for a lot of people, I was like, yep, see, I told you so. There's no way that this franchise can come back from that. That's going to be the last film. Then they made the fourth one, and then they made the fifth one. And then they made the sixth one, and I heard that they was just keep getting better, better, and better, and better. So I said, okay, you know what? I was like, if whatever film they come out next, I guess I will take a look at it. And then tragedy struck when Paul Walker was taken from us before the film was released. So he was actually an actor I kind of enjoyed. He was. Sadly, I put him and Heath Ledger in the same boat. Actors that can do really good stuff, but didn't really get the recognition that they deserve until after they passed away. And, well, Furious 7 is a great send-off to him, and just a great film by itself. And it makes it easier for people who didn't watch the other films. You can still come into this and still really enjoy this. I really enjoyed this film, and I didn't even see the... And I haven't even seen them since, 2002 was the second one that came out? I don't even know. What was the first one? Was 1999 or 2000 or something? Oh, my God. It felt so many years ago. And at the end, they actually show, how it was, all the way back then when they first started the Fast and Furious series. And how young everybody looked. Except Vin Diesel. He kind of looked the same. So, once again, we're back with the characters that you really enjoyed from the other films. And if you like the other Fast and the Furious movies, you're probably going to get more out of it than me, because Jason Statham is in this and he's killing people. So you might recognize some old faces here. And I swear, Jason Statham was in a totally different movie in this one, but he was absolutely fantastic. He was doing his transporter thing in the Fast and Furious movies. I swear these movies get somehow spliced together, and it's so good. It's so fantastic as far as the action. I was really invested in what was going on. And if you haven't checked it out, check it out. It's really good. It's a great send-off to the series, although I heard that they might be making another one. Don't do that. This was a great ending, and it's most likely I'm not going to watch the other one. Paul Walker is gone now. He was actually one of the only reasons why I actually came back and watched this franchise, even though people said that it was getting better and better. And I did make myself a promise that I will watch the next one in the series after Fast and Furious 6. So, really enjoyed it. And, yeah, that's about it. Okay, so let's move on to the next one. Number 8, The Revenant. Yeah, I recently saw this movie. I actually saw this movie before I saw The Hateful Eight. So this was possibly, I think this was like earlier this month, I saw this movie. So not too long ago, possibly about a week ago. So people possibly think that this was going to be a little bit higher on the list. It is not. It is definitely from one of my favorite directors who movie Birdman, Alejandro Gonzalez, Birdman, who made my number two spot and the best list of 2014, and eventually went on to win Best Picture of the year, Best Picture at the Oscars. It was a really fantastic movie, and I wanted to see more from this director. So when I heard that he was making another one, and with one of my favorite actors, Leonardo DiCaprio, of course with Tom Hardy is also in it as well, who does a fantastic job. And I'm gonna get to the acting in a second. I didn't know he was directing it at first, but when I found out, I jumped at the chance. I was like, oh, I can't wait till this movie comes out. And then it started getting a lot of praise from critics and audiences. They said it was really good, you should go check it out, it's fantastic, and blah, blah, blah. Okay, so, you know, there's a lot of hype buildup behind it. I saw it, and I was like, okay, it was good. I don't think it was great, honestly, but I think it was good, you know, enough to reach the eighth spot. And it's mostly due to his directing and its acting. The cast in here is very good. Pretty much everyone works out, even like random side characters. These people who play the Native Americans do really fantastic. The action is well shot, and Alejandro has this sort of like long shot thing that he's doing now, and there's more edits here than in Birdman, which was fantastic how it just kept like this one long shot with barely any edits in it whatsoever. This one just basically just going off the actor's performance, but with that one didn't have like a lot of, you know, big name actors in it or a lot of actors in it. It mostly focused on one thing and stayed in one place. This one's kind of more on going on to a lot of different locations. A lot of different characters are introduced and disappear later on for certain reasons. So there's had to be some changes here from his sort of Birdman directing to this more of a solid directing. And he does do some of the Birdman tropes in here as far as directing goes, but it works out. It definitely works out. And like I said, it's mostly because of the performances themselves. Leonardo DiCaprio is fantastic in this film. He can definitely be up for an Oscar for this one. I have to say, I know everyone's focused on Leonardo's performance in here. I have to say, Tom Hardy's performance I thought was really good. And I think he should get some recognition for that, because this was a better performance than his Fury Road performance, which was good, but it was mostly just a lot of grunts and just there. This one was more on actorial, theoretical. Is that the word I'm looking for? It was more like, you know, he was put on a theater performance, and it really works here. So, yeah, I thought it was a good film. I don't think that it was exactly the better film in terms of we're talking about this or Birdman. I think Birdman was a lot better. But overall, I did enjoy it, and this was coming from one of my favorite directors, but I wish this could have been higher up on the list, but there was just better movies that came out. But anyway, if you guys get a chance, definitely go check out The Revenant if you have not. It's up for Best Picture. I don't think it's going to win Best Picture, I have to say. I wouldn't choose it for Best Picture. I wouldn't, but performances, we'll see. We'll see. I think there was also some better performances going on last year. But this is definitely in the top 10, which is why this made the list. So, yep, there you go. The Revenant, number 8. Good film. Didn't really live up to its hype for me. I think people hyped it a little bit too much, okay? So, yep, moving on. Number 7. Straight out of Compton. Fuck the police coming straight from the underground. Y'all nigga got it bad because I'm brown. You know this was going to be on this list. You should have known it was going to be on this list. Dr. Dre's and Ice Cube portrayal of their rise to stardom with N.W.A. and how they became the entrepreneurs that they are today turned out to be a really good film. Guys, honestly, you know, I thought this was going to suck. I really thought this was gonna suck. You know, what was the last film we got about a rapper? It was Notorious. I think it was about Biggie, and I was like, okay, you know, I kind of like it. It's a bit mediocre. You know, I thought it was gonna be like that, but this is how Notorious should have been. This actually, a lot of movies can take notes from this movie in terms of balancing multiple characters and having you actually follow these guys and get to know their story. You get to care for them, and then. You know, if you remember the real life events, it follows it pretty well, and also showing a lot of the behind the scenes stuff, such as Ice Cube sort of this disputation with his manager, and him ultimately leaving the group, and then him going up against the group, and then how Eazy-E came to. Well, they don't necessarily say how he got the HIV virus, okay, how he got AIDS, but it's definitely hinted at as to not who it is, but, you know, how he got it. Of course, and you know, if you lived through that time, you remember that. You remember this happening, and it brings back a lot of memories to a time where rap was actually a thing. This has some of the best music in it I've heard in a long time, even though that their songs has been out for years, okay? It's definitely enjoyable. O'Shea Jackson Jr., I think that's his name, is Ice Cube's son. Does a really good job of portraying his father to the point where it's kind of scary. It feels like, you know, that is a younger Ice Cube up on that screen. Even from the way he talks to the way he looks, and oh my God, it's just so scary. I can't remember the guy who played Dr. Dre. Was it Darren Hawkins? I apologize if I'm butchering your name here. He does a really good job portraying Dre. Eazy-E's actor does really good. Looks a lot like him too, by the way. Everyone works out here. Everyone works. And you also have, oh my God, Paul Giamatti as their manager, who is just fantastic in anything he's in. I remember being pissed about him having that small role in The Amazing Spider-Man 2. And I was like, fuck it, man. This is Paul Giamatti. You got to give him a better role. And he finally got one. So I was so happy to see him in this. And it really works. The directing is very good. Like I said, it does a good job balancing these sort of these characters and what they're going through, and knows who to focus on, when to focus on, what to talk about, what to show, and it almost works on almost every level. I cannot see why this movie isn't put up for Best Picture. This is better than The Revenant. I'm sorry, it's better than The Revenant, and I have no idea why it isn't put up for Best Picture. I think it's in the music category, but, you know, that's going into the Oscar controversies, okay? And I'm not doing a controversies list, all right? So I'm just going to leave it at that. Overall, Straight Outta Compton is a very amazing film, groundbreaking film from its director. And, you know, if you haven't checked it out already, check it out. Fantastic. Moving on. Number 6. Mad Max Fury Road. So I've heard that this was going to be the last Mad Max in the series from George Miller, which is fine. This was a good one to go off of. The entire thing is basically a Mario Kart race. And I know the memes and internet parodies have already been made about it, but it is really a enjoyable film, mostly just on the action alone. It keeps that level of the Mad Max experience there, where there's not really much story. Just, I guess there's more of a story here than the actual other films. You know, it's just sort of like, but it keeps that whole trope of Well, hey, here's Max, and here's him just getting caught up in this situation he has nothing a part of, but he makes himself a part of it, and he helps out in any way that he can. And Max is played by Tom Hardy in this as well, which I just stated earlier with the Revenant that this is possibly a role where he just sort of grunts through sort of everything. But pretty much the person who takes away this film is Furiosa. And I can't remember the actress who plays her, so forgive me. I know a lot of people love her. For some reason, I can never remember her name. I see her in so many things, but I can never remember her name. She does fantastic in here as a very strong, independent female character, and she takes no bullshit, man. I love it every time she was on screen. So this film, it uses practical effects, you know, with a mixture of CGI, kind of like what Star Wars eventually did as well. And it works both ways. It shows that we can still have real stunts going on. We can have real stuntmen doing this stuff. We don't have the CGI over everything. So I'm glad George Miller came back and decided to do another one of these, because it's such a great blend, something that George Lucas could have learned from. And it works out. It definitely does work out. And that's about all I can really say about it. Mad Max Fury Road, it's a big-ass race to the finish. That's it. Just an enjoyable film. Okay, so that was number six, and let's move on to the next one. Number five, Ex Machina. Oh my god, this was a film that not a lot of people know about it. People should know about it. So good. I actually went to go see this sort of like on a limb. I actually didn't really have, it wasn't anything at the movies at the time that I really wanted to see. This was the time when McFarland U.S.A. and stuff was coming out, so. And there wasn't bad movies, but just Ex Machina just sort of stood out from all that. And it's sort of this Pinocchio, this dark Pinocchio-ish type story. And it's only played by about four actors, and Oscar Isaac is in this, who also is in Star Wars, who plays Poe in Star Wars. And he's enjoyable. This was actually one of the first films I've seen him in. I actually didn't know about him until this movie came out. And I'm glad to say, I'm actually glad that I watched it. I said glad twice in that sentence, didn't I? God. It's really hot up here, man. I just had to turn the heat down, which is why it took me a while to come back up here. But, of course, I'm going to edit all that out. So, anyway, Ex Machina is about a guy who creates this genius, who creates this intelligent AI who is self-aware. And after winning a contest, which I'm pretty sure the guy cheated, after winning a contest, one of the employees at his company, this is sort of like a kind of an illusion of Apple, actually, went a trip out to his estate, which is all the way in the woods, of course it is, at this big-ass, beautiful mansion that he basically created himself. This is how much of a genius this guy is. And Oscar Isaac pulls it off as sort of like the everyday genius. Like, he's really down to earth, really cool, really charismatic. But he's one of the smartest people in the world. So he wants this guy, when he comes there, to stay with him for about a weekend, I think. A week or a weekend. He wants him to sort of interact with this AI and basically give him data on how she interacts. Because he's kind of afraid to release this to the world, but at the same time, this is such groundbreaking technology, how can you not? And then from there, the movie takes twists and a very dark turn towards the end that you don't see coming, and you kind of see coming, and you're like, damn it, I knew I should have got that. But it surprises you, and it really works, and you're just so invested in it whatsoever. Oh god, I can't even speak. You're so into it. You're just really into it. And the girl who plays the AI, I can't remember her name. She does a fantastic job of pulling off this like pulling off this soulless robot who you don't know whether she's actually sympathizing with you or whether she's just pulling your chain. And It's such a great blend of suspense and mystery to where you're just like, I don't think I fully know what this character is thinking, and the entire movie is like that. You don't know where you know what this character is thinking. You don't know who the real bad guy is, although the movie's trying to say, oh, this person's the bad guy. Maybe you should still be skeptical about this person, but oh no, this person just kind of proven that they are the ones that need help and stuff like that. And you know, saying any more gives it away, but it's a really good mystery if you're into those sort of movies, and it all takes place in one location, so there's not really like much of the traveling around. So it kind of reminds me of a dark version of Her, which featured Jaquan Phoenix and came out in 2013. So it's kind of like Her and a dark version of Pinocchio put together there. It's really good. It works really well. It's such a great blend there. So, that's my number 5th spot. So, let's move on. Number 4, The Martian. After that horrendous year of Exodus, Gods and Kings from Ripley Scott the last year. Oh my god, this was such a callback to what he's good at. Sci-fi. This was a very enjoyable film. This is much better than The Revenant, if you want to know that. And for some reason, I'm gonna keep on bringing up The Revenant. I don't know, just didn't live up to that hype. Okay, so anyway, I just kind of hit the desk there. Anyway, The Martian actually does live up to what it promises. And it was another movie that was sort of getting a lot of praise from both critics and audiences. So when I went in, I went in with high expectations, and I really wasn't disappointed. This was a long film, as all most of Ripley Scott's movies are, ever since the Alien movies, or movie, he only did the first one. This was a much more enjoyable experience than what I thought. And it's mostly done through the visuals and its performances from its characters, such as Matt Damon. And there's also a number of other actors in there. I'm not going to really go with too many who's in there. Jessica Chastain is in this. Michael Pena is in this. I can't remember the other guy's name. There are certain names I'm kind of forgetting right now. I apologize. This is long. It's a long video. I need to take a break in a second here. This really works out. Okay, so here's how it is. Matt Damon is just a member of just one of the astronauts that are actually taking a trip to Mars. Of course, we somehow made it to Mars, and we're walking on Mars and everything, and blah, blah, blah. So anyway, so they're doing like an expedition on Mars. A storm comes their way to the point where they have to leave the planet. Matt Damon is left behind, and he is forced to fend on the planet by himself, which is completely deserted. He is the only man there, and he uses basically just his wits alone to survive for months on end on this desert planet, which is supposed to be basically inhabitable for humans. So after NASA figures out through some science trickery, don't worry, the movie actually makes it make sense, for him to contact NASA and tell them that he's still alive. NASA has to figure a way how to bring him back after thinking that he's been dead on this planet for days. They have to figure out a way to bring him back home safely. Let me just say how this works, how they figured out how to do this and how they got this all to work out really blew my mind, man. I was like, how are they going to get through this? How are they going to get through this? This is a well-written film, and I'm not going to give anything more away on this. I'm actually going to start making these descriptions a little bit shorter because I'm getting kind of tired here. I'm getting lightheaded. It's so hot. Okay, so it works out. It really does. And this is definitely one of Ripley Scott's best. But the writing is really what sticks out here. If you just want to see one of those well-written, well-directed films from Ripley Scott, this is it. This is him back to his formula. He needs to stick to this. Leave religious movies alone! Please! He's one of my favorite directors. I really don't want to see him go down, man. But it's so funny how you can make one piece of shit one year to make something a turd, gold the next year. Okay, so That's it, The Martian, number four. And so let's move on to the top three. Here's number three. Number three, Inside Out. Okay, you guys knew this was coming, all right? Oh man, definitely one of Pixar's better movies of last year. One of Pixar's best in a long time. Inside Out plays with the idea of the emotions in your body having their own sort of personalities and how that would play out if that actually existed. Nothing too unique here. This has been done before with older shows, as well as I think movies have done it before. But for how the way it's presented, this sort of lesson that they're trying to go for here, and that really stands out, such as maybe you need a little darkness to go with that light, that sort of thing. Or in the case of the movie, excluding some Kingdom Hearts stuff, you need a little sadness in order to get to the happy part of your life. And you know, if I say any more, it's giving it away. But if you haven't seen the movie, which is really sad, you really should. I actually made a review about this. You can go and check that out if you like. And I explain a lot more there. But from what I'm just going to say here, this is Pixar at its finest, people. This is actually right now my new favorite Pixar film. And Pixar has sort of been like on a roller coaster ride in recent years. They haven't had too many bombs, but you know, it's been definitely relevant for what's been good and what hasn't been good. But this one ultimately works out for it, especially with an all-star voice cast. And yeah, it's fantastic film, man. It really is good. This movie beat out all the other ones on this list. It took the third spot. I was actually debating whether this should be in the third spot or the fourth spot, because I really like The Martian. But ultimately, I put this up here because of the message that it gives out, and it's such a good message for kids and adults both to get. Making this a fantastic family film, enjoyable for everybody, and whether you're into animated films or not, you still might get something out of it. It's just really good. This is really good. This is some fantastic writing with some beautiful animation to complement it. Just one of Pixar's best, man. Very good. Okay, excuse me. All right, so moving on to the next one. Number two, Creed. Yeah, I just seen this movie. If you guys didn't know about me, I am a huge Rocky fan, all right? I brought all the movies from Rocky, from the first Rocky to all the way to Rocky Balboa, and it's most likely I'm going to buy Creed whenever it's released. This is a fantastic film to sort of bring the franchise back into the limelight and continue the Rocky lore, but also starting something new with the son of Apollo Creed, who is played by Michael B. Jordan, and he is fantastic in here. Him and Sylvester Stallone have a lot of chemistry together. You actually feel like they care for each other, and there's a fatherly bond that's actually being made here, to the point where don't think I'm giving this away, but spoiler warning, Rocky gets cancer and he decides not to fight it. He lost basically everything. His wife, his best friend, he has nothing left. And then this kid comes into his life and he's like, no, or this young man comes into his life and he's like, no, Rocky, I gotta fight Rocky. You know, you can't let this beat you. If I'm going to fight, you're going to fight. And a fantastic performance from both of them. This was a film that definitely took a lot of pointers from the first Rocky movie. Out of all the Rocky movies, it took mostly from the first one in terms of what it was going for. And with that being said, you can kind of expect how the ending's going to turn out. Did I just give that away? I think I just gave that away. So like I said, I said spoiler already. So you know, if you're still listening to the spoiler part, okay, spoilers ending now. If you still listen to the spoiler part, that's on you. but anyway, this actually turned out to be a really good film and great film actually. And there's just not much more to say about it. It's great. You should check it out if you haven't already. And now we're going to move on to my number one pick. Number one. All you guys should already know what this is. Play the title card. Star Wars. Oh my God. Was I waiting for this movie for like 2 years? Ever since the rumors that there was going to be another Star Wars film, especially after Disney brought it out, that they was going to make an episode 7, it was going to continue from where the older films left off. I was so excited, but sort of skeptical due to the prequels that was released not too long ago, about 10 years or so earlier, a decade earlier. So I was kind of skeptical going in, but knowing that, you know, Disney has been doing well as of right now, I was like, okay, you know, I can kind of see how this is going to work, especially if Disney is attached to this with their wonderful writers. So the film came out. It was received with a lot of praise from critics at first. Even the actors who went to go see it at the premiere said it was fantastic. Seeing it, you know, even though they're in the movie, you know, seeing it all put together and edited together, it's different than when you're acting in something and then seeing it afterwards. Just like with YouTube, it's different when, you know, I'm filming this video right now to when I'm going to see it later. And I said, you know what, I could have said that a little bit better, or I can fix this in post-production. The film had a lot of hype behind it. So when I finally got a chance to go see it, I actually took my mother with me, who was a big Star Wars fan, and I go into a lot more detail in my review. Once again, I'm not giving away any spoilers here. Even if you've seen the movie already, it's been out for a couple of months now. This lived up to its hype. I'm not going to say all the movies on this list, okay? Probably from movie 4 and up. And which one I said was number 4? Yeah, possibly from... No, okay, number from 5 and up. Oh, no, 4 and up. I'm sorry, I was right before. From, like, where... Number 4 was The Martian, right? From 4 and up, all these movies on my top 4 lived up to their hype. And Star Wars lived up to its hype the most because it had the most expectations from a lot of people. So when something that high can live up to that hype, it's golden, man. It's absolutely golden, and I loved every minute of this film. Of course, you know, there's going to be some more criticism that's going to come out about it being pretty much like A New Hope, and it is. It's like majority of it is like A New Hope, and then the second part of the movie is kind of like the Empire Strikes Back sort of thing, kind of like half of Empire Strikes Back. So as it goes on, we're going to have some, but this was like all of the character development in here, but as it goes on, we're gonna get some more development and some more action scenes and whatnot as we go forward into the franchise. But for what this was, this was the same realm as Creed, and it brought the franchise back to its roots, and it delivered on something old and new at the same time. Bringing something fresh, but still keeping like that old nostalgic feeling from the original trilogy. This was a fantastic film to go off to end for the year, and I look forward to what they do next with the Star Wars franchise, especially with episode 8 and 9 being in production. Yeah, guys, that's it. My number one movie is Star Wars, and I know, I know when I'm picking for best, I'm not going to pick like what I said last year. I'm going to predict the movie for best picture, because there are some movies up there that I've seen that don't deserve to be up there. I'm going to be honest, and I already know about the Oscar controversies that have been going on. I've been trying to avoid talking about it, but it's kind of inevitable now because I'm doing a movies list. I can agree with where a lot of people are coming from, especially after seeing these movies. And like I said before, if a movie didn't appear on this list, does not mean that it's not good. It just means that I possibly didn't see it, or it just didn't live up to my expectations. I didn't like it personally, okay? So don't take it personally if there's a film that you like and it didn't appear on this list, okay? This isn't the definitive list of 2015, okay? You know, if you want to watch a more popular list, go to watchmojo.com. You know, they have some good stuff. Or just go to their YouTube channel, Watch Mojo. They have some really good lists. Sometimes I agree with them, sometimes I don't, you know, or you go to Rotten Tomatoes, something like that, okay? So, yeah, guys, that's it. I'd like to thank you for watching the top 10 best movies of 2015. I hope to see you guys in my next video. And here, stay tuned for the special announcement I'm going to have in a sec here, which is going to explain what's going to happen to this channel for the future. All right, so, guys, hopefully I see you guys in the next one. And I have to do the top 10 worst videos now, all right? I don't even know if I'm going to film this in the same day. I'm going to try to. I don't even know how much time I have. What time is it? Man, it's almost like 5 o'clock here. Okay, so I'll just go ahead and do that. And, yep, I'll catch you guys in the next one. Take care. So hey everyone, this is the special announcement section, and don't worry if you've seen this on whether the top 10 best list or worst list, it's still the same video. I just spliced it at the end of both of those videos that saved me a lot of time doing so. I'm actually, as you can tell, this is actually before I even record those videos because I haven't even finished my list yet. As you can see, it's completely blank here. I haven't even changed my shirt. I haven't even shaved either, so this is actually done before I release those videos because I wanted to do this first so I can edit it and then I can, you know, just attach it later on at the end of the videos. So here's what something I wanted to talk about quickly. I'm going to take about a week or two off from YouTube, and after these videos go up, of course. And I'm doing this because I've actually want to get started on my DeviantArt page again. I have been neglecting it for like the past 2 years. Every so often I will go back and like write something, but I haven't been too productive with it because I've been concentrating more on YouTube because I have a lot more followers here than I did on DeviantArt. So, you know, as YouTube, as my channel got a little bit higher in subscribers and started getting some more views on certain things, I said, okay, you know what, I'll just focus on YouTube for now, then I'll go back to DeviantArt whenever. So this is the time to go back to DeviantArt because there's like a mixture of things going on in my personal life right now. It's nothing like health related or anything like that. As far as going to work and then doing school and taking a class I really don't need or I really don't want to take, and I'm forced to take as a recommendation for me to graduate. This is from somebody who has enough credits to graduate, but you gotta take this class because it's part of the program or something. I don't know. So I'm taking a class I don't like, and I have to study for a test for that. And like I said, I already have work and everything like that. And then doing this, such as, you know, I'm gonna keep the videos coming, as such as reviews, live streams, and gameplays, you know, that people like to see, and every so often, possibly a reaction video, depending on what's coming out. Like I just did Batman vs. Superman yesterday, so, you know, if it's a movie I'm anticipating that's coming out, let's say they release the Assassin's Creed trailer tomorrow for the Assassin's Creed movie that's supposed to be coming out later on this year. Then I would look at that, and then I'll give my thoughts on that as well. So it's that sort of thing. So, you know, and people like that, you know. Some people subscribe to me for the reviews or for the reaction videos or for the gameplays, and that's fine, you know. So I want to do that. I still want to entertain people. I still want to go out and see movies and give my opinions on them, and review them appropriately. And I am going to be doing that as we got some upcoming movies that either just came out or are about to come out. Like I said, such as Batman vs. Superman, Suicide Squad. And we also have the Deadpool movie came out today. That's the day I'm recording this. Kung Fu Panda 3 has already come out. I haven't seen those. I'm going to see those. I'm going to do a review on them. But just going to take a break from YouTube for a while. And I really want to work on my stories because I still have some good ideas up here. So I'm getting way too comfortable with my videos. So I really want to do that. And I really want to push that. So I'm going to concentrate on that for a while. Can you... You guys can see me. As you can see, there's a sun in the corner there. That's actually my lamp. I don't know why it's so bright on the screen. So, I want to take some time to concentrate on that. And so this is for the people that watch, that like to watch my videos. Then, you know, some people will unsubscribe from you if you don't upload regularly. They think you will, even though they don't look at your past and see that, you know, something would be like 1 month and 3 weeks. But people would still, you know, unsubscribe for you because, oh, he's not uploading anymore, so let's just forget about him. So I try to keep it to one video a week. I'm going to try to do one page a week over on my DeviantArt page. Okay, the link is always going to be to the page on my homepage on my YouTube channel. The homepage on my YouTube channel is going to have a link to my DeviantArt. There we go. And like I said, the people will just unsubscribe to you for any numbers of reasons, especially if you don't upload regularly. And I always get a message every so often from the people that I'm working with, and they'd be like, hey, are you doing fine? Are you doing okay? And I'd be like, yeah, you know, I'm doing fine. So like I said, I earn revenue off my videos. So if I'm gone for like a couple of weeks, it doesn't mean anything happened. Hopefully not. So if I upload one video 1 week and I do upload something the next week, or if I upload two videos 1 week, I most likely won't upload something the week after that. That's the reason why. It's because I'm working on my writing. So something has to give. You know, I can't do it all. So something has to give. So I'm gonna have some hours, some free time that's gonna be coming up, especially next week, and I'm gonna go see Kung Fu Panda 3. But I also want to spend that time writing, because there have been some really amazing things coming out from all types of animation studios that's been giving me a lot of inspiration, and I just can't let that go by. You know, I have to write for that. And some people do like my writings. You know, it's always, if you want to check out my DeviantArt page, you can go ahead and read some of my old stuff. It's a lot of fun for me to do. I like to write. So I also like to do videos too, but I like to write as well. So, that's it. Yeah, that was the announcement right there. So once again, thanks you guys for watching for whatever video this is, whether this is the best list or the worst list. I don't know. Like I said, I'm going to attach this to the end of both videos. Yeah, once again, thank you guys for watching. Make sure to like the video or dislike the video, depending on what you think, whether you agree with me, blah, blah, blah. Okay, it's not like I'm repeating myself, so I'm just going to end it here. Thank you guys for staying for the special segment, or if you just skip to it, I really appreciate it, and thank you guys for watching my videos.